Welcome back, Ambassador Mitchell.
Thank you.
So please tell me, what's the most noticeable difference between your previous trip and this trip in Burma?
Well, this trip, the election season was heating up. I think that dominated the discussions, a sense of a possibility for the elections coming up, but also some concerns about whether the election was truly going to be free and fair, and a sense that there was more and more at stake in the election than simply 48 seats in the parliament. So I spent a lot of time talking to folks about in the government and in the opposition parties about what was at stake if the elections were truly free and fair, and what was required in order for the international community to be comfortable that it was free and fair.
So yesterday they announced the invitation of the foreign observation team, you know, during the election observers. Mm-hmm. So this is sort of an overture for the free and fair election. Can you consider so?
Well, it's a very positive gesture. This has never been done before in Burma, and I think that's to be welcomed. There are concerns that, of course, observation is not simply on election day. It's a process. The free and fair election occurs before the election, as well as the day of the election, and then, of course, the post-election period as well. So we need to be on the ground, I think, early in order to talk to people about whether intimidation is going on, to take a look at voter rolls and such. And to see, of course, on election day whether we can watch the vote count. There's still some questions involved. But the fact that they've invited people to come in and take part is a very, very positive signal.
I have to repeat the old question here. If the election goes very well, smoothly, so what will be the reaction on the basis of event by event, what Secretary Clinton said on this particular process, what will your response?
Well, I can't say specifically what we'll do in response, but certainly if the election is a fair representation of the popular will within those 48 constituencies, then we will be responding and we will be taking steps. And I think relatively dramatic steps, I think, in terms of what we'd like to do to be partners in reform in the process. But I can't tell you exactly what we'll do at the moment. But I think what's most important, and it's more important than what steps we take, is the steps that the Burmese government can take to reassure voters and to send the signal that it's important that an atmosphere of trust and that environment, a safe environment, is present during the election period, so that people can vote their conscience and people can feel that on election day and then afterwards that their will is respected and that people are going to be representing them honestly in the parliament. That will be a tremendous confidence building gesture for the people of Burma and for the international community.
And apart from the election, what are other benchmarks for lifting sanctions?
Well, there are a number of benchmarks that are in legislation in terms of the ethnic conflicts, of making sure that there's a path and a process towards national reconciliation, the human rights abuses that do continue to occur in Kachin and other places around the country, that those are phased out. There is not forced labor, there is not all the other litany of things that we've been concerned about. This, of course, all these things, I think, need to be in place. And of course, when we talk about democracy, it's not going to be simply one moment that creates the democracy, but it's going to be a process leading to 2015 that as well will tell us whether sanctions should be lifted.
That means there will be sanctions imposed even after the election, a free and fair election, that means, possibly.
I think it's fair to say we're not going to take this election as the end point in terms of that reform has run its course and we're, you know, that all of the criteria for lifting sanctions will have been met. But it is a tangible moment in the process of democratic reform and of political reform in the country. So it's not something that we take lightly and that we will be responding to. But there are other factors, I think, that will go into lifting sanctions.
And internationally renowned academics, economists like the Professor Stiglitz, including him, they are saying the sanctions are the stumbling block for the reform process. It is hindering the reform process. What do you have to say there?
I think Joe and others, even people in the country, U Myint, who's a leading economist, advisor to the government, he wrote that, look, it's not simply about sanctions. There are other factors. There are domestic factors. The government itself has to create conditions to promote investment and promote the right economic environment for development in Burma. So I don't buy that sanctions are the things, are the fundamental obstacle to development. I think there are conditions that the government and Burma itself has to create in order to promote development. What we want to do, and I think what Joe Stiglitz was talking about, is be a partner in reform and change some of the things that are obstacles to reform. And that's what we're looking at now. If these elections are reasonably free and fair, then we are willing to take certain actions that we think are obstacles to reform, and in that way assist the development of the country.
And another thing is that when you talk about the investment, there are some concerns that the people in Burma, those can grab the opportunity, are only the cronies. Apart from the cronies, there is nobody else to grab the opportunity of foreign investment. Yeah. If you have to decide to go for the investment, you know, how will you protect that sort of accumulation of all the investment and properties and wealth in the cronies? Yeah.
Well, the system is rigged to a great degree and is controlled because of the way it's been for so long. So we have to be careful that we are, by our actions, assisting reform, assisting the movement away from the privilege of the few to the benefit of the many inside the country. So jobs are the most important. And I heard this from even ministers and leaders in the government of Burma in Naypyidaw. The most important thing is whatever we do when we engage is to create jobs, create opportunities, and give people a sense of hope and a sense of tangible benefit to this reform process. They hear a lot about reform. They see it at the center in the political and to a degree social realms. But at the everyday life and economics, et cetera, they don't see it. And I think we can perhaps assist with that in some fashion. If the conditions are right, and it's not up to us, in fact, it's up to the government to create those conditions.
And how about the judiciary? There's also very serious concern of international. Yeah. There are judiciary miscarriages all the while happening in Burma. So how can the United States help in this area?
Well, it's going to be a long-term. The issue of rule of law generally is going to be a long-term challenge. And this is not just something the U.S. government is concerned about. This is what any investor or any economic player in the country is going to be most concerned about, is whether they will get a fair shake, whether they will be able to trust in contracts, trust in their engagement that they won't be ripped off. So the rule of law, independent judiciary, have the infrastructure that undergirds development and economic change, that's what I think is going to be most important for progress and development inside the country, and we'll be watching that.
I'm not sure whether you feel the sense of anti-American sentiment in some of the political elements in Burma, but one of my colleagues in Burma interviewed a high-ranking USDA official, and he said, we don't want Burma being pulled by the, you know, following the other foreign instruction. That is our stand, they said that. That means we can interpret that as Western countries.
Yes.
What do you have to say that?
Well, I would hope they would be independent. They are an independent country. They're a sovereign nation. We're not telling them what to do. They're going to make decisions for themselves that will be in their own interest. But I think it will be in their own interest to take some of these actions, not because the U.S. government says so, but because it does create the conditions for what they themselves say is best for their country, which is respect for human rights, democracy, national reconciliation, and development. But no, I would fully expect that the people of Burma would decide what's best for the people of Burma. But we do have an interest in the United States that the people of Burma truly are able to speak and represent their will, that not just the few at the top, not just the military, not just a single political party or elites and cronies have a say for their own benefit, but the broad cross-section of people of the country. So yes, we do have an interest in that, and we will be pursuing that as a matter of our policy.
Yes, apart from that sentiment of anti-Americanism, another thing is that military is still behind the curtain, some people point out. So these two facts can make, you know, the irreversibility impossible in Burma.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
What do you think, is military still behind the curtain?
Well, Aung San Suu Kyi has said that. When they asked her about reform and reversibility, she said the key factor is the military. I think that's true. The military has a unique position within the Constitution. The military has the ability to act with impunity, essentially, still, and by constitutional writ can ignore what the government tells it to do, what the president tells it to do. So this is a concern. They have to be brought in. I think we have to see, I think, a sense that there is civilian control, or at least some constraint on the military over time, in order for people to feel that this is really taking hold and being institutionalized.
Yes, and one more thing about this, the opposition NLD. Aung San Suu Kyi, do you think Aung San Suu Kyi could live up to the expectation of the entire people, not only the entire community? All roads go to Aung San Suu Kyi at the moment. You know, everybody is putting their expectation with Aung San Suu Kyi. Do you think she could live up to that expectation?
Well, she's a remarkable person, and I've met her many times. I've met her 6 times now. And she is a remarkable individual, and she means so much to the country. But she even says, she says herself that she's not an icon, she's a politician. And she will have to operate within the constraints of the system.
Yeah, how about her team behind her? They have been under the military control for decades, so do you think they have enough experience? And
Well, I think if they stay true to their values and true to the will of the people, and they're listening to the people and their constituencies, yes, I do think they have the ability to represent that in parliament and to do right by the country. So I have no doubt about her abilities, and I think many of the people around her are quite competent, as there are with other political parties. It's not just about the NLD. There are ethnic parties, and there are some in the USDP, certainly, and there are people in the military that will be part of the parliament. I think together, if they're unified and find a way forward, I think certainly it'll be a positive change for the country.
And I would also like to know the attitudes of the ethnic people. You met ethnic leaders for several times. Mm-hmm. What is their feeling towards the union? How do they feel about the unity of nationalities to integrate in the process of the country's political system? How do you feel there?
Well, I mean, ethnics is a broad term. The diversity among the ethnics and diversity within the ethnic communities about the way forward. I think there is some degree of hope, increased sense of possibility, mm-hmm. that there may be an opening with the government to engage in dialogue and find a process to deal with the underlying political issues, among some. Among others, particularly Kachin, I would say, and there are some others, there is a sense that really nothing has changed. And there is that sense overall. At the center, there's something has changed. The localities, very little has changed. And the violence continues in the Kachin state, and I mentioned this during my visit, a great concern about the violence and the internally displaced persons. So it depends who you talk to. I can't tell you that there's a single view among ethnics, but I think some do see possibility, more than they've seen in a decade or more, while others, I would suggest, probably feel that it's the same old, unfortunately.
I just want to ask you two more questions, and second last is, who have you chosen the election monitoring team, or will you be one of them?
We have not selected who will be on the U.S. monitoring team. I will not be part of that, I don't think.
So will you be on your own during that election time in Burma?
I myself, personally? Yes. I won't be in Burma then, no. My next trip will not be during the election, but watching very closely. And as I say, a lot is at stake in the election. We hope that the government can send the signal of how important this is, and how send a signal to the people that their vote will be respected, that the environment is going to be safe for them, and that anything that suggests intimidation or other coercion or other things that may disenfranchise them will not be tolerated. I think there really is an important point now for the government to speak proactively on this, not the international community, but the government to send that signal.
And my last question is, tell us about the, very briefly, about the event taking place in the Australian Embassy this afternoon. You're one of the speakers there.
Yes, well, there's a report coming out from something called Project 2049 about aid assistance strategy or assistance policy. So I'm just going to give some comments there about aid. And
in the report, I briefly saw that ASEAN Regional Human Rights Organization, she is focusing that issues things. Mm-hmm. How influential those organizations will be in Burma human rights?
Well, it's a work in progress. I think ASEAN Human Rights Commission and such are a work in progress. There is a great diversity within ASEAN, the differences on the definition and the desirability to promote human rights in other countries. The non-interference principle still remains important. It's an important contribution. I think ASEAN is evolving in the right directions, and we obviously are very committed to the viability of ASEAN as an institution. But I think what's going to have most impact on Burma will be Burma and the internal Human Rights Commission and the internal processes and civil society and opposition political parties and the government, all in partnership. That will be the most important.
Thank you very much.
Sure, thank you.
Mr. Ambassador.
Okay, thank you.